1870 by George Catlin. The book name is Shut Your Mouth and Save Your Life. It is written that on mouth breathing at night, that man knows not the pleasure of sleep. He rises in the morning more fatigued than when he retired to the rest, takes pills and remedies through the days, and renews his disease every night. This was written almost 150 years back, and after 150 years, if you are seeing Shark Tank, there is a person called as Mark Cuban who's invested $500,000, that's more than 3.5 crores, in just a device which closes the lips. Okay, so this is the importance of what I'm going to talk about, keeping the lips closed during night, during sleeping. The next slide, as you can see, it's an article published in Lancet by Christian Guillemot. Everybody knows who Christian Guillemot is. The article was described about, can we avoid the development of a narrow airway and secondary abnormal breathing during sleep? Okay, and I would just show you the conclusion. What it had written is, mouth breathing during a critical period in childhood leaves an indelible stamp on a craniofacial architecture that lasts a lifetime, and 60% of the facial growth is completed by 6 years of age. Even still, without attention to the continuous effects of accompanied oromotor dysfunction to correct mouth breathing, the work of orthodontic expansion and surgery might be in vain. So here he is told that we have to address the oromotor dysfunction along with the orthodontic expansion and the surgery. This is so why does the tongue fall down? The first reason, as Dr. Deen Dayal sir in the morning was telling us about prevention of sleep disordered breathing, he was talking about bottle feeding, the unnatural practices that we are doing, that is the first thing which leads to low tongue posture, which leads to a narrow palate. This is a small
airway and TMJ. The normal way to breathe is through your nose. As we grow and develop, certain things such as
this
pollen,
is going to talk about how mouth breathing leads to a narrower jaw, and it becomes a vicious circle of sleep disordered breathing, later leading to sleep apnea.
As the tonsils and adenoids become swollen, they develop into an obstruction for nasal breathing, and slowly mouth breathing begins to be the primary intake of air into the body. In order to breathe through the mouth, the lower jaw comes down.
So as the tongue goes down, the buccinators push it
the
whole
is the correct way for air to enter the body,
and it leads to more amount of narrowing of the arch, the V-shaped arch, and the deep palate that we were talking about.
During mouth breathing, the pressure from the cheeks is unopposed by the tongue. The oral system becomes unbalanced and results in the deformation of the upper jaw, creating a V-shaped arch as opposed to a correct U-shaped arch. This also
leads to something called as a tongue thrusting. I'm not going to take a lot of time in this.
Airway.
So as we now know, this is also being written by Guillemot. When the tongue is placed behind the palate, it correctly stimulates the intermaxillary synchondrosis, leading to normal orofacial growth and normal nasal breathing. This is about how if the tongue posture is low, it leads to something called as a tongue thrusting, and if tongue is not on the palate, it leads to tongue thrusting, which leads to more amount of narrowing of the upper as well as the lower jaw. Here these are the articles showing about establishment, how nasal breathing is important because it lessens the angulation of the occlusal plane, it shortens the airway length, it shortens the soft palate and improves the function of the dilator muscle itself. So I am going to ask you, which one are you going to prefer if you want to breathe underwater? We are going to prefer a larger airway. At the same time, we will be preferring a stiffer airway. We need a stiffer. That means there should not be any collapsibility of the airway. Okay. The best surgery, we say, one of the good surgery for sleep apnea is maxillomandibular advancement, which helps to increase both the airway in upper as well as the lower arch. So how can we do it naturally with something called as orofacial myology? These are just about few of the articles. How should we normally be swallowing? We normally should be swallowing with the tongue resting on the palate. If the tongue is resting on the palate, it will get the proper growth of the upper and the lower jaw. This is just about chewing, the importance of chewing. This is just a short video about Akshay Kumar and Narendra Modi. You can just see how much time he chews this food. So that is what we are not doing, because our diet is getting softer day by day. So now coming back to our topic, how orofacial myology is going to help. So the first thing of orofacial myofunctional therapy or oral myology It's ENT consultation, evaluation and treatment followed by maxillary expansion, mandibular advancement. This maxillary expansion, mandibular advancement has already been talked about, Dr. Gayatri. I'm going to talk about orofacial myotherapy for correct breathing, soft tissue dysfunction, tongue posture and swallowing. So we had done some of the children we had taken for orofacial myofunctional therapy. Now I'm going to talk about the treatment. The first thing that we do in order to establish the correct tongue posture, we use something called as a coloplast resin, which is applied to their palate, which helps the children to understand where they are supposed to keep the tongue, which helps the proper growth of the jaws. There are some appliances like MyoBrace that also helps to correct, help to get the tongue on the roof of the mouth. Other thing that we are going to teach children is about the nasal breathing. There is something called as a breath hold test. Okay. Now here I am going to also speaking about oral OSA. Yesterday we had learned there are a lot of relapse cases of, there is not 100% success due to after surgery of oral OSA. That may be due to the elevated loop gain, which is one of the strongest determinant of OSA. It could be due to the increased arousal threshold and airway recruitment. So, if in such children there has been theory that there is an elevated loop gain in people who has a residual OSA, so for that we do some exercises which are called as spaces or breath hold test, which has also been shown in one of this paper by Massino, that elevated loop gain during sleep can be identified using breath holding maneuvers. This may have implications for personalizing OSA treatment. And for that we do something called as spaces, where which shows that slow breathing, which also helps to reduce the cremo reflex response to both hypoxia and hypercapnia. These were just about article one of the, also one of lastly I would just mention one of the article relationship about the dental overbite and eustachian tube dysfunction, where it had shown that every cases of deep bite are at a higher risk of developing ETD. Okay, so we can also treat that, because these children are usually having tongue thrusting, that's why they are having deep bite. That can also be treated with help of orofacial myotherapy. So in conclusion, I would just like to say that apart from all the treatments of surgical and pharmacological, we should also be using myofunctional therapy to establish the correct nasal breathing, at the same time correct tongue posture. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Amir. That was very nice. A new angle which you don't think over, the nasal and the oral architecture is settled in the first few years of life. So if you can really modify by these means, few exercises and restructuring the whole thing, maybe we could avoid nasal surgeries and morbidities in the future.
Absolutely. Very nice. We have formed a foundation of orofacial myotherapy based in Mumbai. So now we can actually come all the ENT people as well.
They have to work in tandem. The department of ENT and myofunctional have to work together.
Yes, everybody has to work together.
Thank you.